Hey guys, what's up? It's Alex Shirelli. Welcome back to an episode of Ask Alec, where I take your questions and answer them here in short videos. If you guys want to ask me questions, click the link below, alectorelli.com/askalec. You can send your questions to me and I'll pick the best ones and answer them here in future videos. If you like this stuff, be sure to subscribe to my channel. That lets me know I'm putting out awesome content for you guys that I know you're going to love. And that's it. You guys are amazing. Leave a like, leave a comment. I'd love to hear your feedback. I do read all my comments, try to respond to as many of them as I can too. So that's a great way to connect with me as well. This is a question I get all the time, like whether it's from people emailing me or DMing me on Instagram, or like literally clients that want to work with me in one-on-one coaching format that are always wondering this same thing. Can I make a living playing poker? Can I play poker professionally? How hard is it to do? Or like, what is realistic? And a lot of times people come to me and they want to work with me because they want me to assess their skill and tell them like, what level can they beat? You know, because they don't know what they don't know and they want to try and get better understanding of like, how realistic is it that they can beat 2-5 no limit? How realistic is it they could beat 5-10 no limit? What's their win rate going to be? What's their hourly rate going to look like? And what does it really look like to be a professional poker player? So I'd like to address this in a video. I get this question so often that I feel like it warrants its own video. And I'm going to lay down the hammer here and just say what I believe is true, that in 99% of people that play poker aren't going to make a living playing. And I would say that 95% of people that play poker aren't going to win. That's just true. Now, if you're watching this video, you're watching this channel, you know, there's a chance that you're on the higher end of the spectrum of those players, and you might be part of the 5% that are going to win, or 1%, 2%, 5%, whatever, that are going to play poker professionally, just because 85% of poker players never study, they never watch videos, they never do any training. So don't be like scared that that's definitely you, but let's just look at the global economy of people that play poker as a whole and just state that that's the fact. And that is the fact about any esoteric profession, right? If you're a writer, people are, you know, like writing, they post things on Medium or Quora or their own blog, but like 99% of people that write aren't gonna make a living writing. And that's the same that's true for acting or play tennis. Like, and that's just how poker works. And I want you to think about other industries, other niches that are like that, that have that 99-1 ratio, and just get a more humble understanding of what it really takes to reach that, well, I guess just a better understanding of how the economy of poker really works. Okay, so that's how I believe it's like. I think tennis is a great example. Well, tennis isn't a great example because even people in the top 150 in tennis are like backpacking around. But yeah, like those other esoteric professions are good examples of what I think it takes really in poker to make it. And so it's kind of ironic because in poker, you know, most people don't think they're losing, right? Like nobody really thinks they're a losing player, just kind of like sex and driving. Nobody's bad at those things. And poker kind of falls into that category, whereas people are more realistic about their skill set in another hobby, another niche, another industry. Whereas like if you ask me, Alec, how good are you at basketball? I have a very realistic understanding of how good I am. If you ask someone how good they are at drawing, people are very realistic about their skills. Nobody's saying, oh, I'm so good at drawing, and then you see them draw and you're like, this guy's abysmal. But that happens all the time in poker. And so the reason I'm kind of laying down the hammer here in the beginning of this video is I want people to be self-aware, to understand like where they are on that spectrum. I don't know if you're excellent or abysmal, but like I know that in general, the trend that I've seen throughout my career as a poker player or coaching or from readback or readers, I don't know why I just combined those two words. Oh man, this is my fifth video today, so I'm losing it a little bit. Is that people drastically overestimate their ability, and I'm guilty of this too. Like, I noticed that myself, my own like self-awareness thoughts, like sometimes when I sit down to the game and I'm playing like a really tough game in Macau, it's like, I notice that my natural inclination is just to like think that like, oh, I find edges in this spot and nobody else does, when in reality, like all the excellent high stakes players in Macau are doing similar things to what I'm doing. It's not like I'm better than them or like someone is that much better than all the players. Like everybody's very equal and it's a game of inches, but everyone probably thinks that they're like a little bit better because they're like, oh, I flat here in spots where nobody else flats, and I have my range is this in this spot. It's like everyone's, you know, a lot of people are doing that, right? And so I just feel like everyone overestimates their ability. I've been guilty of this in the past as well, and I know I see it all the time. So all this is to say that it is difficult to make. So there's two sort of aspects of this. One is, how hard is it to be a winning player, and how hard is it to be making a living playing poker? And there are definitely orders of magnitude in between these two things. Being a winning player is one thing. It's actually not, I mean, it's hard, but it's doable. Like, it's very realistic for a lot of people that are studying poker and that work hard at poker. And you don't have to be like great to be a winning player, because depending on how often you play or what your goals are, or what stakes you're playing, you can like cherry pick and game select and like make money playing poker by using other skills than your poker ability. You don't only have to be great at poker. You have to be a good poker player. You have to manage your money correctly. You have to not tilt. You have to play when you're winning. You have to know how to cut your losses. You have to know how much money to risk in a game. You have to understand which players to play against and which games to play in. And like, so there's other things you can do besides just being technically good at balancing ranges and check raising, etc., to be a winning poker player. And so I think it really requires both. I always tell my clients and readers, 50% of what you should be focused on is being better at playing the game of poker, which is strategy. And the other 50% should be being a better poker player, which is mindset, bankroll management, tilt control, playing your A game, peak performance, what you're eating and how it affects your ability for cognitive function. All those things are required to be good at poker. And if you think about other niches, other games, other industries like tennis, yes, you have to be good at technically, knowing how to serve, but you also have to, have a good footwork. You also have to, be able to be motivated, to be disciplined, to get up early, to play every day. You have to hustle. You have to eat well. You have to have a clean diet. Like Novak Djokovic, famous for changing his diet, and he wrote a book about it and how that affected his tennis ability to go from, never winning a major, but I think never winning a major or always struggling and getting beat by the top players, to being dominant, best in the world for, a 5-year run or whatever it was, still one of the best in the world today winning majors. So, and that didn't have to do with his ability to play better tennis, but it was to be a better tennis player. And that's very true in poker as well. And if you want to move up the ranks to be a winning player and to be play full time, you have to have both. And so many people focus all their energy on, I just want to be better at playing poker, but very few people focus on being a better poker player. But the reality is that most people overestimate their ability. They aren't self-aware. They play in games they shouldn't play in. They tilt money off. They don't play their A-game poker. They have bad bankroll management, and then they're bust. And so I've known good, great even poker players with amazing ability that are broke. And the truth is that 90-something percent of poker players are broke, not because they don't necessarily have the right answer, not necessarily because if you ask them how to play a hand, they can't answer it. They can. It's just they don't have the other things that we just discussed, which are required for being a professional. And this is why I'm laying down the hammer here and making a tough love video, because I love you guys. I want you guys to have that perspective, because this is all required. Everything we just discussed is required, and more is required for being a professional poker player, for making poker your goal and your main source of income. You also have to have support for the people around you. It's like, even if you have all those things and your wife doesn't support you and your family doesn't support you, like, what are you going to break up your marriage to play poker? Like, there's so many things that have to be required, and there's so much that has to happen that it's difficult to make it. And the other thing I would like to say is that there's just amount of luck involved as well. Whereas in other industries, there's not really luck. Like, there's luck in terms of like being a best-selling author, right? Like, you have to kind of, you can see how even if you're a great writer, you have to just kind of have it work. You have to have the right publisher and the right agent, and like your book has to hit the market at the right time and have the right title and the right image on the cover, like, to be best-selling. And like, there's this domino effect, and there's kind of like that in poker too. You don't have to win tournaments to be lucky, and like, sure, the best players are going to win in the long term, but the reality is the long term is way longer than people think. So most people say like, oh, the best players are going to win, but the truth is that most people that want to take a shot playing poker don't have the long term in their pocket to reach that long term. So even if they are a winning player, they might lose before they reach the long term, and then they might go bust and then not end up ever having the chance to make a career out of it, not because they weren't great, but just because variance wasn't on their side. And that's a harsh truth about poker, where it's like, it's the same thing as if you're a writer. Like, you might have a best-selling book in you, it might be your third book, but the reality is if your first book tanks, Most people aren't going to spend the next 5 years writing to create their masterpiece. Like, they don't, practicality sets in and they don't have the patience or the discipline or the drive to do that. And poker is very much the same. Like, most people that quit, like, whether they quit their job or not, or they're serious about poker, they want to give poker a shot. If they don't win in the first 3 months, they might be like, this isn't for me. They might not have the mental fortitude to handle losing. They might not be able to deal with the variance. This might be true even if you are winning in the first 3 months. You might win for 3 months and then lose for a month and be like, fuck it, poker's too much. I can't handle it mentally. I need to have a stable job. I want to have stable income. And so for all these reasons, it's very hard to make it at poker and then make it long term and then play long enough to where, like, you reach that long term in poker and then you basically don't ever make a career altering mistake. So for example, let's say that you overcame all these obstacles we talked about and then you run it up. Like, now you run up $250,000 bankroll and, like, or you win a big tournament, right? And you're flying high in poker. You have the chance to be, you know, you've reached all your goals and dreams and you're there in the top of the poker industry or whatever, right? Then you have to not make a mistake. And it's so much harder to not make a mistake in something like poker than it is in a job where you're getting paid, because in a job where you're getting paid, like, I'm not taking anything away from that, but, you know, if you reach a certain position, you're much more likely to keep that position than you are to keep your position at the top of the industry in poker, just because, you know, if that job, you have to meet your metrics, which you already probably proved to have the competency to do. And if you have a bad moment in your job, you're probably not going to get fired for it. There's a little bit more job security around it. But if you have a bad moment in poker, you can lose all your money in a day. And that's just not, the same equivalent doesn't transpire to a job where you can lose everything in a day unless you, like, steal money from the company. But, like, people don't do that. So, like, in poker, you can have a bad, you could play well for 6 months and then have a bad week. And you take a shot and, you know, you have $250,000 bankroll now. You take a shot at 1500. The game gets kicked up to 100, 200. You have a bad week and you lose like 200K of it. And then mentally you're so set back that now you don't have the discipline or the will or the fortitude to grind 5-10. And you maybe just, you're like, 50K feels nothing in the face of 250. You make a bad decision, you lose that. If you go broke in poker after building up a huge bankroll, it is so hard to recover and come back. I have a video about this. It's about coming back from $1 million downswing that I had. In 2018, I was one of the biggest winners on Full Tilt Poker. No, 2018, sorry. When I was 18 in 2007, I was top 10 biggest winners on Full Tilt, right up there with Patrick Antonius, Phil Ivey, Tom Dwan, Phil Galfond, I think. We're all the biggest winners on Full Tilt Poker, making over $1 million a year in cash games. I also won the biggest tournament in online history that year for $250,000. I had an amazing fucking year. And I was 18 or 19 years old. 2009 or a couple years after that, 2008, I had a really bad year online poker. The game moved ahead. I got a little arrogant about my ability and I was taking shots in big games, playing 200, 400, 300, 600, no limit hold'em, heads up against, you know, great players. And I ran bad. I also played not, which caused me not to play my best. I was outmatched a few times playing against players I shouldn't have played against. And I lost. I lost a lot of money. I went on a huge downswing and had to go back to playing 5-10 after playing 200, 400, 300, 600. That is extremely hard to do. And it took me, like, I had to take months off. And I feel like if that happened to me now, I'm 31. Like, if I made that mistake, I mean, I don't, knock on wood, I don't think I'd make that mistake now because I made that mistake when I was young. But I was lucky to make that mistake at a point in my career where I didn't have the, like, I wasn't in the place in my life that I am now where if I make that mistake, like, I don't think I'd go back to playing poker because it's just, I don't know what I would do now. But let's say you make that mistake when you have, like, two kids and a family. You lose your huge bankroll. You're not going to come back to playing poker. Like, it's over. Like, you have responsibilities in your life. You live in practicality. Your family and wife and kids aren't going to give you, like, a second shot. You're, like, bordering on the degenerate gambler side of things. And so, but when I was 18, it was like, oh, it was an expensive learning lesson. I knew I had the talent. I knew I could do it. And I knew that I had the time horizon to do it where I didn't have the responsibility in my life. So much of it is timing too. And a lot of people don't have that time window. And that's what I was talking about earlier, where it's like, they don't have more than 3 months to make it work because they live in the real world. And they're like, their family and the life around them isn't going to support them for longer than that. Or they're not going to give you know, they're not going to go longer than 3 months without making money while they're spending money on their living expenses, etc. You know, and this is more true for some of the people that are not old, but older watching this video. You know, if you're 35, 40, 50, you have a life responsibilities. You know, if you're 18 to 24 watching this video, you know, you have more of that time cushion to start up your own company, be an entrepreneur, or play poker, whatever that is. So it just depends on where you are in life. And there's so many factors that go into it that I feel like it's hard. I hope I shared some useful perspective on what it's like to play poker. I would also say that, you know, you see people on ESPN or Poker Go or Poker Central, whatever, that make it. But you have to think about poker like a sport like tennis, where it's great if you're at the top. I'm not gonna lie, like the lifestyle that you can have and staying at the top is easier once you're at the top too. That's very true in poker, because then you're surrounded by all the best minds that help, you know, you get better and you know where the action is, you get in the game, you just kind of learn how to thrive and do it. But to break through that barrier is very tough. And certain small amounts of people live amazing lifestyles because they have all the freedom they want in the world. They can travel the world full time and play poker and play in high stakes games. And like, that is a great lifestyle. But that is, you know, even of the professional poker players, there's varying degrees of professionals. And a lot of professionals are like sort of struggling to get by or not making a lot or playing 2-5 and maybe 5-10 or whatever and just trying to pay bills. And like, it's a grind. They're playing 40 hours a week and it sounds like a dream, but it's also a grind. Like, they have to study, they have to work hard, they have to stay the game. The game's getting harder. You know, they're sitting in a casino all day and it's really a grind. They have to play their best and they also have to be good at the other things that we talked about in this video, where like they can have months where they lose money, and that's part of being a pro, which is not part of other jobs. So it comes at a cost. And sure, a small percentage of people live incredible lives and have it made, but a large percentage of the people, even a large percentage of the pros, don't have that. And they deal with other negative downsides too. So I would say, in short, and this is, take it for what it is. I think it's a strong statement that I'm about to say, saying this. Even in my experience, I think you want to be able to play poker. You want to be able to have the talent of a pro. You want to be able to compete as a pro. You want to be able to make money in the game. But I think it's not ideal to rely on poker to make a living. And that's my opinion, and seeing thousands of readers, clients, students, people that I'm observing, and professionals, and just people that come and go in the industry. It is very hard to make it long-term as a career. And I think that the best balance of poker is to be able to play but not have to play, and use poker as that side hustle. So you have your own entrepreneur business that you're running, or you have your own job because you have your own business, you're successful, whatever you are doing, whatever you're doing. And then poker is a great thing to have as a slice of the pie. It's really tough to have as the whole thing. And I think having it as a slice of the pie is an amazing lifestyle. It is an amazing balance. It is great. Imagine, you know, you work your own business, you run your own company, you work your own job, you do something you like, and then you're also a winning poker player. And so now, you know, you can go to 4 tournaments a year. You're like, I want to go to the EPT Barcelona. I love going there. I go there with my wife often. Or I want to go to Australia, or I want to go to the Bahamas, or I want to go to the World Series in Vegas. And so you say, okay, I want to go to these 4 tournaments a year. It's going to cost me this much money to go. I know I'm going to make this much money per hour, whatever. So you're kind of like hustling it. You're kind of like a part-time pro, but you're not relying on that. It's not your main thing. It's like a free roll. It's like traveling with benefits, right? It's like having a lot of air miles, like, because the company gives you air miles. You're like, I'm going to go there anyway, but the fact that I could go and pay for the trip and make money on the side and have a chance of making $1 million, being on TV, being a legend, whatever, is just cool. And that's the balance that I would say works for most people that I find. Most of my clients aspire to that balance. And that's what I think is the best place to be, where, and this is coming from someone who's made their career as a poker player, right? So it's hard to say this because I haven't been like that most of my career. I've been just exclusively relying on poker. But even still, and just seeing how it affects other people and what is most realistic for most people, I think that's the best balance. And you don't have to have all of the talent of a professional, because you can kind of cherry pick your games. You're going a couple times a year. You can pick your games wisely. You can choose amazing tournaments. You also don't have to have the mental fortitude and the lifestyle, deal with the lifestyle implications of playing day in and day out and winning and losing and what that the toll that takes on your mind and dealing with months without making money, because you're doing this part-time. You're doing it, you know, 4 to 6 trips a year, or, you know, you play poker on weekends and you have a separate bankroll for poker where, you know, if you lose a couple thousand in your separate bankroll, it's not going to affect your life because you have that money set aside for poker, and this is like your startup fund or whatever you want to call it. And that's a great place to be. It takes all the pressure off of playing professionally. It allows you to enjoy the game more. And I think that's a great balance to have. That's it for this video. If you guys like this, subscribe to my channel. That's the best way to let me know that you like this content. Like this video, give it a thumbs up, and leave a comment below. Let me know your thoughts. Are you a professional poker player? Do you play on the side? Do you use it as a part-time hustle? Do you have questions about this? Definitely let me know in a comment below. I would love to hear from the community on this one. And I know this hopefully it's a insightful, deep video. And I really gave you some perspective on what it's like and what are some of my raw thoughts on what I'm seeing in being a professional poker player. So like this video, give it a thumbs up. If you do, that would be great. And I'll see you guys next time on the channel. If you have questions, alectrelli.com/askalec. I'll pick the best ones and answer them here in future videos. You guys are awesome. Much love, everybody. Thanks for watching. See you guys next time. Cheers.